Should we go over that combo again where you climb up and sit and then I do a kick up?
Okay, sit up and you hold my hand.
Yeah.
I think pole dancing is a form of artistic expression and also a form of sport. You have to be extremely fit to do it. You have to have lots of strength. Also, you have to be graceful as well to make it beautiful because pole dancing can be really, really beautiful. You know, you're spinning on the pole and you're doing these amazing tricks and, you know, it's extremely strenuous and, you know, and you have to show the strength and beauty. That's what pole dancing is to me, and it's really liberating. Just being up there, expressing yourself artistically and showing that you're strong and fit and showing off your muscles.
Yes, I am the
act. Oh, okay, what's your name?
My name's Matty.
Matty, and what are you going to do for us?
I'm going to do a pole dance performance.
Matty, if you want to show us what you do on the pole, sure. I'm interested in seeing it.
He took what was potentially frightening experience and turned it around and made it his own and just dominated. And my heart leapt for him because I was so happy that he'd done such a great job. And it was just amazing to see the way the judges responded to it.
Oh, my Lord, we laughed. It was so funny. We all laughed. I think everyone laughed. I thought he'd slip off. Oh, my Lord, I said, he's going to fall.
The first time I saw Matty on Australia's Got Talent, I was speechless, actually. It was insane. You know, it's weird when you see someone that you know so well suddenly on national television, particularly on those shows where millions of people are watching. And I think I was so proud of him at that moment because I think it really gave him confidence and really gave him the push that he needed to say that he is good enough to entertain Australia and the world.
And I was gunnering myself backstage. I was so nervous. I was pacing up and down. The producers had to like tell me to calm down. I was so nervous. But when I got on stage, I was like, yeah, the stage is mine. Nah!
Pole dancing has really come a long way in the past 3 or 4 years. I think most people would probably associate pole dancing with what you see in strip clubs and bars, but the way that it's performed nowadays in competitions and in dance studios like mine, it's a very acrobatic and gymnastic form of performance. It's probably more similar to aerial circus than anything else. When Matty first walked in and took his first class, he was already doing stuff that it took me 2 or 3 years to be able to do. It is unusual, but I think, thanks to Matty, awareness of male pole dancing is definitely growing. It's no longer seen as something very strange, which it used to be, I guess. He's really put it on the map for male pole dancers, but I think there is still a little bit of stigma out there that it's a strange thing for men to do. There's nothing wrong with being strange.
Well, with my pole dancing, I like to incorporate like an indigenous dance fusion with pole. I put contemporary Aboriginal dancing into it. you know, do a lot of contemporary Aboriginal dancing on the floor, and I use elements of Aboriginal dancing on the pole as well. So it looks very earthy and very, you know, like artistic. I feel like I've promoted Aboriginal culture and, you know, in a sense that I incorporated the elements into the pole, you know, and I've brought it to the world and showed the pole dancing world, hey, this is where I'm from, you know, like I'm Aboriginal, I'm an Aboriginal Australian man and we're amazing, you know, yeah. That move. See this, when I first started this move, it's called the left leg hang.
Yeah.
It really, really hurts.
I've known Matty for 5 or 6 years now. Over that time, I have become his manager, getting gigs and getting the word out there to get performances and spread the word of Matty. Do you want to do a routine like that for the upcoming one for Australia Day? Matty is becoming more in demand. We've had bookings from Sydney Festival, Australia Day Council, and there's NAIDOC Week. There's been interest and it's growing.
She's one of my best friends and she supported me all the way through, you know, Australia's Got Talent, you know, and now she's my manager and she was there at the auditions and also my performance at the semi-finals in Melbourne. We do a lot for each other and she offers me lifts everywhere and I take them, you know. Yeah, so some people would say that she's my wife, yeah. Yeah, she's my wife. She does everything for me. But she's not. Yeah, she's not.
I like hanging out with Matty because it gives a space that I haven't had much in my life, and that's of a close friendship. And whether it be just hanging, chilling on the lounge to having dinner, or sometimes even just going down the beach and just watching the waves, watching the water. Good.
My hometown is Walgett. Walgett is a beautiful little country town in the northwestern parts of New South Wales. Gorgeous, gorgeous people, amazing people. And it's on two rivers where they meet. You know, I always, you know, describe myself as a Walgett boy or Gingy Mission boy, you know? Yeah, so I'm really proud of that, saying that I'm from Walgett. The only way I can explain why Walgett is so special to me is that I always have a longing to go back home. It's like a calling, I can't explain it, but like I'm always threatened to go back home, you know, like I always want to go back home to my family and to my country, you know, like. I was brought up by my great auntie, who I call Mum, and her husband. They both brought me up, along with their other children. I was a good child, but at the same time, I was very evil, according to my family. I was a real bad boy.
Most of the time when we went to Dubbo, he was a naughty boy. He was in the shop. He'd nick things and he'd take them outside and throw them near the car, and he'd climb up on the ladies' rack where their dresses hang, and he'd sing out to my daughters. Like, where are the girls? I can't see the girls. He got down and he turned the fire hose on. Water everywhere, all over the clothes. And the lady come, she said, "What happened to you? Turn the tap on." One lady said, "I seen one of the Aboriginal boy." Matthew run for the dresses. He was all wringing wet. But Matthew, he was a happy child. He never had a fight with any children. He loved singing and dancing.
Yeah, I used to dance around in the backyard. When I was a little kid, there was this really cool song. It came out on, like, Rage. It was, like, early 90s, you know. And I was singing it to my sisters, you know, dancing around. I didn't know what the words meant, but I was singing it with my sisters. And my sisters were just cracking up laughing, you know. And they brought me to my mother, you know. I was, like, dancing around my mother, like, doing these ones, you know. And the song was like, "Let's talk about sex, babe." Like that. And my mother was like, "Ah, what you know about sex?" And it was so funny.
As he grew older, he was a good child, he was. Matthew. I feel proud of my son. Everyone in Walgett was talking about him, how proud they are.
All right, good to see you.
Good to see
you.
And he put Walgett on the map. Even the white people pulled him up in the shopping centre. Even young girl asked their dad to take a photo with him.
Smile down.
All my little nieces and nephews, they always run up to me and jump on each arm, one on the leg, one wants to get on my shoulder, you know. And it's just so warm, you know. For me, life at school was good. But it was bad as well, yeah. It was good in the sense that I kept my mind occupied and, you know, they had art at school and they had dancing and stuff like that. And it was also bad in a sense because at school I felt like an outcast amongst my peers and, you know, so I was called names a lot at school and it really affected me and my growth as a child and really scarred me. I started going to the Catholic Church in Walgett with my auntie and I became religious. And so the church then asked me, "Do you want an opportunity to go to this school in Sydney by the name of St. Joseph's College, Hunters Hill?" And so I said, yeah. And then I told my mother and my father and they jumped at the opportunity and said, yes, take him, you know, take him away. I remember the last day I left Walgett when I was 16, I got in the bus and then I remember, you know, leaving the levee bank of Walgett and I was like, oh, I'm so nervous and I was really, you know, at that time I was threatened. I was homesick already as soon as we left that levee bank. When I arrived at Joey's, I was terrified. I was in this great big 100-year-old building and so I had to go up these elevators and walk through these corridors and go through my dorm. I started to learn to read and write. For a while there, I couldn't even make out the letters, like, yeah, because I was so illiterate, whereas other children were really, you know, succeeding and their levels were really high in reading and writing, so I felt really left behind and really dumb and really stupid. And I think, you know, growing up, I was told that I was stupid a lot when I was a kid and that I was dopey and so that really had a significant effect on the way I learned. So I couldn't read because of that, because if you tell somebody that they're stupid or dumb so many times, they'll start to believe it. I think I overcame illiteracy because I had heaps of support at Joey's from the staff. And I really wanted to learn to read so I can get along, you know, with my studies. The way I overcome that was just, I was really focused on achieving that goal. I was bullied at Joey's. There were a lot of, you know, name calling and, you know, they used to call me names like Abbo and, you know, or they would say sentences like, "Sniff some petrol." I overheard people say that before. And gay faggot, gay abo faggot, poofda, all these really nasty, horrible words. People would, you know, say that, yeah. I think, you know, I was so vulnerable at that time in my life that I could not get up on my own feet. I think Father Kevin is one of my heroes on earth, yeah. Because without him being at Joey's, I would have been in, you know, I would have been in Walgett, because he fought for me. Yeah, he really did.
Well, my first impressions was that he was lost, that he was trying to find his way, that he didn't have many friends, and that he just needed someone to guide him a little and to just reach out. And so I sought to do that.
When I think of Father Kevin, I think of, you know, not the usual priest. Father Kevin is so out there.
Matthew kept under the radar. He never got into much trouble. I think he was too quiet for that. But he's changed. Not so quiet anymore. You should hear the way he rings me up.
You know, I call him up sometimes and I go, "Hi, bitch." And he doesn't care, you know? Like, he just goes, "Yeah, hello, bitch," or whatever. He just says it back to me. I'm like, "What? You can't say that, you're a priest."
Matthew's flamboyant, has a wonderful sense of humour, has a deep but a simple faith, and very popular among the girls particularly.
I became really religious. It was just very uplifting and very spiritual as well, and, you know, having the whole community in church and having those people around, just the energy that I got from them was really positive and liberating as well. Church was one of them things that would make me feel at peace, because people that were in the church were at peace and they were all happy. Sydney World Youth Day 2008, I had the chance to do a traditional Aboriginal welcome for the Pope. It was really cool, actually. And I had the chance to actually talk to the Pope as well and tell him a little bit about Bennelong Point. I was standing right next to the Pope and I had my hand on his back. So I was like that, you know? Yeah, talking to him about the Opera House and, you know, stuff. You know, I was drumming it into his ear and everything. But I was so frightened because I was scared of sneeze. If I sneeze, because there's snipers everywhere, you know, they might shoot me, because, you know, lots of security guards everywhere. Mm.
When I saw Matthew dancing for the Pope, I had a lot of pride in my heart, and I could understand his Indigenous dancing, but I didn't know that he danced apart from that. So his new adventures in dance were startling to me, because before I entered the monastery, I used to do ballroom dancing, so I used to love to dance. So to see that reflected in his life, I thought that was a wonderful coincidence. Well, I don't think there are many priests who have a male pole dancer as a friend. I'm full of pride for him. But I would never take it up myself.
Well, as a kid, I always loved, like, performing. Yeah, so I enrolled into a theatre performance and practice course at Eora College of the Arts in Redfern there. That's what drew me to acting, you know, just the urge to get on stage and perform and express myself.
Matty's stage presence is fantastic. He's got a lot of expression, but he's able to pull it back and really hone in. And he actually suits more serious parts. The Matty, the best friend I know, is always laughing and loves life and all of this kind of stuff. And yet on stage he can be so serious, and it actually really suits him. I think the whole year was Matty's biggest learning curve in life. He'd come from Walgett and I'm from Bourke, so we're Western kids. I know what it's like out there. It's really tough. And he went through those years with the Catholic Church, and his experiences at boarding school were quite hard for him. So Eora and that year of acting was probably the first time he'd really spent, you know, time on himself. I remember he came out halfway through that year.
I was born gay and I was brought up in a heterosexual world. So at age 16, you know, that's when adolescents are starting to develop sexually, and my view was starting to be attracted to people of the same gender. And I was very confused because the whole world was saying, no, this is the right way. You have to have a wife, you have to have children. And growing up in a small community where everybody's, you know, straight. Well, straight. Everybody's straight. And it was very difficult, you know. And being Catholic and gay was very, very difficult too, because it was people will discriminate against you, and you grow up being fearful of people calling you names or being bashed. And so that's what I found really hard. Yeah. It took me a few years to come out to my friends because I didn't really accept myself. I'm still on that journey, you know, hopefully to the end of that journey soon, just fully accepting myself as a gay man.
He was going through a lot of really serious issues, and a lot of it came back to his confidence in himself. He struggled a lot with racism throughout his life. So he had this idea that he was ugly, and it was because he was black, and he was somebody that no one wanted. I think he's managing it a lot better now, but back then, it was really dark days for him.
I was so lonely, you know? Every time I went out, I was so lonely, you know, in this gay scene with all these white people around, and, you know, I'm the only Aboriginal person there in that scene, and it was just so lonely and difficult, and I felt so alienated, like I felt at Joey's, you know? And it was just, it's just really hard being gay and Aboriginal in the gay scene, because everybody has a warped idea of what beauty is, you know? There's a lot of discrimination in the gay scene, and it's sad.
Mm.
What started me off wanting to become a nurse is when I started to realise that I wanted to care for people. If I want to do real remote area nursing, I have to be a midwife. So I want to have that under my belt as well and learn to deliver babies. Yeah. First year of study has been really hard, only because I haven't studied for 5 years and I'm teaching myself how to study again. But it's been really good because I'm learning another language, you know? I'm learning a science language and a medicine language, you know? And it's really interesting and fascinating, and I'm learning about the world as well in terms of health. Pole dancing and nursing, how are these two gonna fit in together? Well, I reckon nursing is my day job, pole dancing is my night job. And I don't think the two can ever mix, because unless I want somebody to have a heart attack on the bed while I pole dance, I don't really want a code blue on my hands. No way, thank you. Coming from Walgett to Sydney, my life has changed immensely. It's changed a lot, you know. I'm more worldly. If I was to give anybody advice, like, you know, a young child, I would say to them, you know, be opened, you know, be open to every opportunity that comes your way, because, you know, that door could lead you to something else, you know. Be open and, you know, because that's what happened to me. I'm an open person, and, you know, things come to me and I just take it, and I just take it and run with it, you know, and the next thing happens, you know.
I think Matty will end up being, you know, world famous, and I think he will end up being, you know, this huge black celebrity that, you know, that young kids out west in Walgett and Bourke and hopefully other remote places will look up to, and not just for pole dancing or, you know, dancing, but for anything, and say, well, I can go to the city and do what Matty's done.
I feel a bit naked up here on stage without my pole.
Over the years that I've known him and been friends with him, he's become more of his own person and stronger in his beliefs. But it's part of the journey, isn't it?
It's been a spectacular journey. It's been an unexpected journey. And I've been blessed to be part of that journey, and I hold his friendship as one of the treasures that I have.
You know, we're going to be two old men at some point, just looking back on our life now, still supporting each other, and he'll still be on a pole at 70, and I'll be telling him to get down off the pole still. Don't shame me out. That sums up our friendship, I think, there perfectly.
But he cares for other people, and he shows his love to them. I'll tell you, I love my son very, very much, and I'm proud of him.
If I spoke with my 5-year-old self, I would tell me, life is a test, and that it can be very trying and very testing, but be open to every opportunity and help as many people as you can. Yeah.